The producer just signaled you lost Juicy Fruit. I guess Juicy Fruit's off.
What a joke with Papa and Fortune on Netflix is a joke radio.
Sirius XM Channel 93.
Welcome back, everybody, to What a Joke with Papa and Fortune. I'm Tom Papa.
I'm Fortune Teamster.
And we're very excited because our good pal Adam Cayton-Holland is here.
Hello, guys. How are you?
Good, Adam.
Welcome. That's your juicy fruit. That's your parting gift.
Thank you. Nothing like, sugary gum in the early, early morning. I appreciate that.
That's why they put it in a pack. You put it in your pocket. You use it whenever you want.
It's really thoughtful of you guys. Thank you.
You're very welcome.
You'll get two chews off of it, and then the taste will be completely gone.
Perfect. That's all I need.
What?
Why are you shitting on our gift?
No, I'm just telling. I want him to know what experience he's gonna have.
He's gonna enjoy it, and he's gonna flashback to his childhood.
The producer just signaled you lost Juicy Fruit. I guess Juicy Fruit's off.
You have Tragedy Plus Time, your one man show.
Tragedy Plus Time is a book I wrote.
Oh.
And the one man show is called.
I'm sorry.
That's all good. It's called Happy Place. Off of that book.
I knew that.
Fortune knew. She's big up on that stuff.
I knew that.
Wait, when did you write the book?
I wrote the book almost a year ago. It came out.
How'd that go?
It went really well.
Yeah.
It went really well. It was well received and, interesting experience to write a book being a comic, just not knowing the reaction immediately. But
yeah,
it's been really great and overwhelming. And then I've started doing this one-man show recently.
Overwhelming how? What do you mean?
Well, the book is subject matter is pretty serious stuff.
Right.
A lot of mental illness and depression and suicide.
Right.
And so...
This was your sister, right?
Yeah, my little sister. Morning fun time radio.
Yeah.
We're here for everything.
Yeah, no. So that she died like 7 years ago, and I wrote the book last year.
Wow.
And so when you kind of just spill it all out like that, people really respond to it and send you all sorts of overwhelming, nice, sometimes oversharing messages.
Yeah.
But it's been nice. There's a normalization that comes when you talk about stuff like this.
Did you get to that? Was it 7 years about the time when you were able to kind of identify it and talk about it?
Honestly,
take that long? Or
over those 7 years, I'd write like an essay here or perhaps I went on a podcast and had a pretty interesting conversation about it there. It was like whatever level of comfortability I felt just kind of came about organically.
Right.
And then the opportunity to write it came up and I was like, yeah, I think I am ready to start working on it. And truly, writing the book was no joke, processing a lot of it as I was writing.
Yeah.
It wasn't like, I think I've gathered my thoughts and I'm ready to write my tone.
Right.
It was more in writing it, I sort of...
A lot of crying as writing.
Like profound.
Really,
crying.
Yeah.
Yeah, my wife would come up and just be like, you all right? And I'm like, not at all. She's like, oh, that means it's good. Keep going.
Yeah. That's so hard.
Yeah, it was hard. But I'm very proud of how it came together. And the show's a whole new beast.
Had you come back to stand up since the tragedy... Before
I had,
you had.
When it initially happened, it's a messed up story, but I was a new face in Montreal in 2012. I actually remember riding in a van with you because I was a fan. I was like, Tom Papa's in this van. You're a new face. It's all crazy.
And he's an old face.
He was driving the van and we all tipped him nicely.
Sorry.
But it was, so I was a new face there, and it was, when you're a young comic, that's really head-swelling, crazy stuff.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I went there, I did really well, and 2 days later, I came back, and my little sister killed herself.
Oh, how old was she?
She was 28.
Oh,
I was 32. So, what do you do with that? All this career stuff that you're like, I'm making it. This is great. This is what matters.
Yeah.
And suddenly, none of that matters at all. I say this in the one-man show, but somewhere along the line, somebody described stand-up to me as a search to sound like yourself on stage.
Uh-huh.
And it takes however long it takes.
Yeah.
I thought that's really accurate and good. And so, in 2012, I was like, I think I'm sounding like myself.
Right.
And then something like that happens, and you're like, oh, God, I don't know who I am. I don't know what the world is. The world's upside down. So you feel like anything you say when you're not just up there crying or talking about it feels dishonest because you're not really sharing with the audience what's going on with you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Was she always struggling? Or was it just kind of blindsided?
It was kind of a blindside.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's hard.
The last 2 years were, now in hindsight, you can piece A led to B, led to C, led to D.
Right.
In real time, no idea.
No idea.
And
until
it became really dire and sad and bad.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But that's the crazy thing about mental illness I've learned is that, I feel like there's a lot of depictions of it are just too black and white.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And they're like, oh, this person was doing great. And then a switch flipped and now they're nuts.
Yeah.
For us, it was way more chaotic and there were long spells of doing really good and then, mm-hmm. you know, falling off the cliff and then doing really good again and then falling right. off the cliff. So it was just impossible to piece together. Ugh. It was tough, man. It's yeah. the worst.
Was there any other mental illness in the family or was she...
Yeah, you know, but in doing this, everybody's family's got some skeleton
mm-hmm. yeah.
somewhere. What's funny is as evolved as we think we are,
yeah.
I still think we're just starting to scratch the surface.
Oh, yeah.
So, like, mental issues. I mean, we're 20 years removed from electroshock therapy on people.
Right.
We don't know the brain that well.
Right.
We're getting there, but, you know, it's... So that's when people are always like, well, what did your sister have? I just say, mental illness?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean... Just like you'd say cancer. Do you want to discuss the specific types? I can get into it with you.
Right, right.
Ultimately, does it really matter? Like,
mm-hmm. Was she getting help at the time?
Yeah.
She was.
Yeah. My family's like, my dad's a civil rights attorney and my mom's was an investigative journalist and they're big hippies. I have a hyphenated last name because my hippie mom.
Yeah, I was going to ask that.
Yeah, she's
I assume you had lesbian parents.
Well, basically.
I thought he was lesbian.
Yeah. I'm a lesbian, born to two lesbian parents. Point being, you know, with any mental illness issues, there was no stigma in my family. So the second Lydia right. was like, I'm having these issues, boom, we're getting you all the help we can get you,
yeah.
the best help we can get you.
Right.
But, you know, it didn't really matter. She just right. kind of, she'd outfox therapists. She'd get the prescription mm-hmm. she wanted.
Oh, right.
She's a really intelligent girl.
Right.
And I think she kind of just played with these therapists for the last 2 years.
And us.
So
yeah,
it was, you know, what do you do? It's a weird one too, because like, it sounds hyperbolic, but this was my best friend and
yeah.
she was very involved in my comedy. She would run the door at our Grolic shows
oh, really?
And do tech. And, yeah. you know, oh, I'd go after a show the next morning, we'd go out and get breakfast and she'd be like, you should do this tag. You should, you know, just like,
really?
Because we'd grown up riffing together and doing family jokes. So.
She was funny?
She was very funny.
Really?
She was mm-hmm. so dark funny. I mean, clearly.
Yeah.
But that was, so that's like another reason when the Montreal stuff was going on, she had been my biggest cheerleader. Mm-hmm. So when that happened, in the back of my head, I was like, don't throw in the towel. Like she would,
right.
she would very much want this for you.
Oh, that's right. great.
Keep going. But yeah, it's also terrible because it's like now cool things are happening. I want to be like, Lydia, look right. at this. This yeah. is the coolest thing.
Yeah.
But what can you do?
So where are you living now?
Back in Denver.
Oh, you are? You're yeah. back in Denver
Bought
now?
A house in Denver.
Really?
Yeah.
And you're married?
Yep, married. I got a one-year-old baby. Now, he does this thing, not to be new dad, but he does this thing where if he likes anything, he puts his hands up like he's worshiping. He's like, it's very like adulation is yeah. the only way I can describe it. And it's usually reserved for squirrels or trucks.
Yeah, that's right.
But the ocean, he was scared. He just stared at it for a minute and then he was like,
like yes, that a little proper, Frankenstein.
That is the proper respect for the ocean.
That's so cute.
Yeah, so I think he got it.
What does your wife do?
She's a stay-at-home mom now. She's all in.
Was yeah. she into comedy?
As a fan.
Yeah.
But she didn't do it.
Is that how you met her? She came
as... Yeah, her friend who now is out here and works at a production company lived in Denver, her best friend, and was a comedy nerd and kept right. dragging her to our shows.
She's like, again?
Again. Nice. These guys
these
are terrible.
These three guys.
They're just so blue. but eventually, after 5 years of coming to shows or something like that, she came around to me and took a shining to my comedy.
Nice.
So yeah, so we've been married for 3 years.
Oh, nice.
Oh, that's great.
Now we got the kiddo and all's yeah. good.
Was finding that person and settling down healing for you in a certain way?
Yeah, I mean, it's so all wrapped up in it, Fortune. Like we were a newish relationship when this went down.
Okay.
And I was like, after a while, I was so depressed, I broke up with her and straight up because I was just like, I'm not happy. I can't pursue yeah. happiness. I'm not yeah. happy. Like,
right.
I'm sorry, uh-huh. but I'm broken. And she was, you know, heartbroken. We got back together later, but it was just uh-huh. all every type of awful way your life can fall apart. It
yeah.
fell apart for me for mm-hmm. a couple of years.
Well,
besides weird career crap, which I couldn't have cared about less.
Right.
Yeah.
So Katie has been through hell with me and
right.
helped me like get back up and
mm-hmm.
watched me sort of figure out how to walk again.
Right.
Right.
So yeah, she's been there through a lot. I appreciate it.
That's great.
Yeah.
She's a good woman.
If she told you that you couldn't eat cheese again.
I heard that.
Would you stay with her or would you leave her?
I'd leave her tomorrow.
Right. See?
You're like, she got me through hell and back.
See?
But if I can't eat cheese.
But now I'm able to appreciate cheese again.
Thanks
because
to her.
And I think of her every time I eat that cheese.
But I'm dumping her.
But I'm eating the cheese.
Yeah, of course.
You guys are monsters.